It has been 3 months since the insurgency in the Capitol. And what have we learned? Oh, so little apparently, in no small part thanks to the continuing efforts by the right wing to whitewash, sort of literally, what happened that day. Take a look at Tucker Carlson as he looks back on that day and understand, while this monologue is exactly what he said, Media Matters journalist Brendan Carrot decided to add a little bit of a visual component to it to go along with the audio. So take a look at this.
Today is the 3 month anniversary of January 6th. For those of you who aren't good at dates or don't have calendars, this is the day that we pause to remember the white supremacist QAnon insurrection that came so very close to toppling our government and ending this democracy forever. You saw what happened, it was carried live on television, every gruesome moment. A mob of older people from unfashionable zip codes somehow made it all the way to Washington, DC, probably by bus. They wandered freely through the Capitol like it was their building or something. They didn't have guns, but a lot of them had extremely dangerous ideas. They talked about the Constitution and something called their rights. Some of them made openly seditious claims. They insisted, for example, that the last election was not entirely fair. The whole thing was terrifying. And then, as you've been told so very often, they committed unspeakable acts of violence. By the time thousands of soldiers arrived to restore order, an unarmed woman, an Air Force veteran, lay dead. To this day, that woman is the one completely verified casualty of the insurrection, the only person whose death we can say definitively was caused by specific events on January 6th. We know how she died. The funny thing is, you almost never hear that woman's name. Possibly that's because she was not a Democratic member of Congress or even a Joe Biden voter. She was a protester. Her name was Ashley Babbitt. She was 35. We still don't know who shot Ashley Babbitt or why. No one will tell us. But then when you're fighting insurrectionists, you don't have to explain yourself. You just hyperventilate about QAnon and then you do whatever you want. When a group of sad, disenfranchised people who've been left out of the modern economy show up at your office, you don't have to listen to their complaints. Not for a second. Why would you? You thought listening to people's complaints was democracy? No, these people threaten democracy.
Okay, so thank you to Brendan, by the way, for putting those visuals on there, because you'll notice that Tucker did not. And it's not that he can't, he has a full staff and he likes to. Remember, months and months into the BLM protests, he would use footage of fires that he'd put the date on. It would be 3-4 months earlier, he'd be using B-roll of fires. But for there, for some reason, 3 months after the insurrection, he decided to do this sarcastic look back on the event without using any footage whatsoever, perhaps because the footage tells the true story. And so thank you to Brendan and Media Matters for putting that out there. I have thoughts on some of the specific things he said there, JR, but what did you think?
It could be every sentence has an ironic approach to it. So as if it's the people's house, as if they're not supposed to be there. So if I walk, even before January 6th, as we know that has been reinforced because of the attack. Even before January 6th, if I just walk up to the Capitol and say, I'm coming to talk to Nancy Pelosi, I'm gonna walk in because it's my house. I pay taxes, I pay plenty of taxes. Do I get to walk into Washington, to take a flight to Washington DC, walk up to the Capitol and say, hey, I wanna talk to Nancy Pelosi, I'm tired of her madness. Or maybe I should say it, Mitch McConnell. I came to talk to Mitch McConnell, that turtle, I'm coming to get him. Are they gonna let me in? Are they gonna let me in? No, they're not gonna let me in, but it's still my house though.
You could ride a Harley through the front door. Doesn't matter, it's your house. Context doesn't matter.
It just doesn't matter. And again, if after 3 months, now on April 6th, you're gonna talk about how it's a 3 month anniversary of what happened on January 6th. So if you have someone from MSNBC talk every month and go, it is now May 6th, it's June 6th. Been 4 or 5 months since the Capitol attacks, and we're gonna talk about how horrific they were and how much sedition took place, and look at these insurrectionists. If you go through all that every month, you know what people like Tucker Carlson are gonna say? How dare these people keep focusing on January 6th riots? That was over and done with. We took care of it, and there was a couple of few insurrectionists here and there that were probably Antifa. So they're gonna get annoyed that you're continually harping on the devastating events of January 6th. But if he can bring it up every month to talk about how it was not a big deal, what is the motivation? It always talks, this guy goes back to things that no one asked him about, but he's gonna talk about because his motivation is to continue to whitewash, to to have a revisionist history of everything, because that's what we've always done in this country. Except we don't get a chance to do things like what happened here, which is show the reality. You know, folks in power have always been telling us what history is in our country, what the present is in our country. But the difference now is we can show them what we just saw. And he had to confront that too. It was shown wall to wall on your televisions about all the horrible, horrible violence. That's the truth.
Yeah,
that's exactly what we saw. But instead, if you put a little sarcastic tone on it, if you put a sarcastic tone on it, suddenly that doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. That is a manipulation of your audience, because you've molded their brains down to this Play-Doh-like substance that you just change every night. Yeah. Like, you guys are so dumb. I'm gonna tell you that January 6th was nothing every month. And eventually you're gonna go to your friends and be like, you know, January 6th wasn't a very big deal at all. You know, we were invited in, it's our house. We wanted to kill people, but that's all right.
Yeah, and you know, polls confirmed this week, more than 50% of Republicans think that it was either entirely peaceful or it was Antifa that did it. And why do they think that? This, what you just saw, 3 months of Tucker Carlson immediately after the event and up until now, lying about what actually happened there and pretending that we just can't find footage. It just doesn't exist. What a coward. What an utter coward Tucker Carlson is, that he's gonna try to push this narrative and pretend as if there isn't footage. No, be bold, be strong. Show the footage and then imply that it's fine. No, it's acceptable. Yep. Right wingers get to do that. Here's footage of them trying to beat a cop to death with a flag. Here's why that's okay. Be a man, Tucker Carlson. If you're gonna try to push America into fascism, at least own up to a bit of the process along the way. But he won't. He's a little scared rich wuss using the tools that are available to him. For instance, QAnon. A dude will never have the balls to say on air QAnon's real, but he'll certainly imply it because he desperately wants people who believe QAnon to watch his show, which is why he made the little sarcastic comment about, oh, they're saying it was Q. Show the footage of the Q flags and then respond with why it's okay. If Q is great, then actually make that case. Stop alluding to stuff, stop implying stuff, and actually say something for once. But he did say some things, and those things were lies. They didn't have guns. Yeah, they did. One guy had a car loaded with guns. They had pipe bombs too. Notice he didn't bring those up. They thought the election was unfair. Oh, Tucker, follow up. Why did they think that? Is it because of you, your network, and your whole political thing? Is it possibly that that's why they think it? Thousands of soldiers showed up. How long did it take for soldiers to show up? How much damage was done as a result of that? Did he have a problem with that? No. No, loves cracking down on protests. Not so much this one. You don't even have to listen to their complaints. First of all, they had complaints, and what, you know what we had? An election. They lost it. We had runoffs. They lost those. That's how American political complaints are adjudicated, in elections, which you guys keep losing, okay? No complaints don't come in the form of breaking in windows. They didn't just get invited in. It's not just their house. Show the footage of them scaling the walls and breaking things down. Show, for instance, them chanting the names of people they wanted to hunt down. This entire thing is, I am going to push people to violence. I am going to push them to do what I want them to do. And if they fail, as they did on the 6th, then it doesn't count. If they tried to kill people but failed, it doesn't count. Except for, of course, the cop, which they did kill. But they didn't get to Nancy Pelosi, so it doesn't count. And anyone who implies that it's dangerous or we should take it seriously, no, you're being hysterical. You're hyperventilating about this. He spent an entire year freaking out at any time across America that like three black people in BLM shirts assembled. That was chaos to him. It could not be allowed. But this, the 6th, is totally fine.
It's all they've got, because they've built this bias against certain folks. So once you've built that bias against certain folks, you can just say they're the evil ones, and therefore we do these evil things, but we're the good guys. That doesn't matter. It's a game. It's, if you've convinced your followers enough that there's this one side that no matter what happens, they're the bad guys, and no matter what happens on our side, we're the good guys. You can look at the footage of us doing bad things, and you can still say it's a good thing without fully saying so, because you might look a little crazy in saying that. So again, like you mentioned, three BLM folks that may collect for a second, and then you have folks say, hey, pigs in a blanket fry them like bacon. They could not stop repeating it. They could not stop repeating how that is the most vehemently anti-cop, violent rhetoric of all times. Were they, did they break into police departments and start murdering police officers and walk around menacingly saying, "Hey, Officer Wilson"? Did that happen? Did that happen? Did they break into police departments and start murdering cops? And then when one cop shot, maybe in this weird situation, shoots one of the people who dove into a police department, then you go, how dare they shoot one of these people? What was she doing? There was that whole part. She was literally about to climb through a window where there was some senators and congressmen, which were one of the two, 25, 30 feet away. That's who was. And you know who shot her? Who shot her was a Capitol, a Secret Service agent that was to the very last second decided to go ahead and shoot this woman. And now that's, we're not gonna say her name. What happened to her? She was an intruder and a terrorist that day. That's who she was. Fine, say her name. Point out who she was when you say her name. Because when we say everyone else's name, we point out that they were innocent victims of violence.
Sure. And by the way, you know who wishes that she hadn't been shot? Me.
Yep.
I wish she hadn't been shot. But I also am not so stupid and laser focused on the particular moment that she was shot that I can't acknowledge how she got there. You can read about her past and how she was radicalized. She should have never been in the Capitol. She shouldn't have been in DC that day. She went because Trump told her to. She cared to go because Trump and Fox News told her that this is something she needed to be involved in. They got her killed. Someone pulled the trigger. That person's principally responsible. But she shouldn't have been in the path of the bullet. They put her there, and they won't own up to that either. For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.